Welcome, everyone, and thank you for attending today's workshop, which is to discuss the Broadcast Relocation Fund. Before we start, I just want to remind everyone that this session is being webcast at http://www.fcc.gov/live, and it will be archived and available sometime tomorrow. And we'll take questions at the end, so please go up to the mic if you have a question. And if there are any members of our web audience who has a question, then they can submit those questions to our email box, incentiveauctions@fcc.gov. So with that, we'll kick off with an overview of this fund by Bill Lake, who is chief of the Media Bureau.
Thanks, Rebecca, and welcome, everyone. This is the second in a series of workshops we'll be holding to gather information to help us implement the incentive auction provisions of the Spectrum Act. I'm glad to see a good crowd here. I don't know if it has anything to do with the fact that we're talking about handing out money. But we are here to talk about the TV Broadcaster Relocation Fund. This was created by Congress as part of the Spectrum Act. They made available up to $1.75 billion over a three-year period after completion of the auction to cover the costs incurred by a broadcaster that is required to change frequencies in the repacking that follows the auction and that incurs costs to relocate its TV broadcast activities to that new channel. But it does not cover other things such as lost revenues. The statute also authorizes us to reimburse some other costs, costs incurred by MVPDs such as cable companies to accommodate a channel change by a TV station, and the costs of moving non-broadcasters from channel 37 if we choose to go in that direction. But we're not here to talk about those today. So why did Congress create a TV Broadcaster Relocation Fund? Anyone who's been hearing us talk about incentive auctions knows that we think a repacking of the band, a realignment of the band, is necessary after the auction. If we receive contributions of this 6 megahertz in this market and a different 6 megahertz in another market, it simply wouldn't make sense either from a broadcast viewpoint or a wireless broadband viewpoint to repurpose those individual channels. We would have problems of interference between the services, and we wouldn't produce the blocks of spectrum that could be efficiently used for wireless services. So we need to realign the band so that there will be certain frequencies that continue to have TV broadcasting and other frequencies that will have wireline or wireless activities. Now, everyone in this room recalls that the TV industry recently went through another transition not too many years ago from analog to digital facilities. In that instance, TV broadcasters bore their own costs of replacing analog equipment with digital equipment. Maybe because broadcasters had fairly recently gone through that transition, in this instance, Congress decided that the costs of changing channels in connection with an incentive auction should be paid by the federal government. And it will be paid out of auction proceeds up to the amount of $1.75 billion. The fund also gives us a timeline because it tells us to complete the repacking and the reimbursement process within 3 years after the auction. So we're kicking off the planning process for implementing these reimbursement provisions. As we do so, we have three principles that we're trying to serve as we try to put together the basics of this program. First is simplicity. We want to hold to the absolute minimum the cost of implementing this reimbursement program to both the government, the FCC, and broadcasters. Second is promptness. It won't help anyone. It won't serve anyone's interests if this process drags on. And the third is fairness. We want to cover the reasonable costs of broadcasters. That's what we're told to do by the statute. We obviously also have the duty of any federal agency to avoid waste, fraud, and abuse, because we're dealing with money that, if not spent for this purpose, will go to the federal treasury. And finally, it's important to keep in mind that the touchstone here is reimbursement of cost. This is not Christmas. It's not winning the lottery. It's reimbursement of costs that are actually incurred by broadcasters in changing channels as a result of a repacking. We've identified a lot of issues ourselves already, enough to realize that this will be a daunting process. Some of those involve drawing the lines on hard and soft costs to reimburse. Another set of issues are whether we need to pay the exact amount incurred by each broadcaster for each item, or whether it's possible to create some predetermined bands of expenses, either for all costs or for particular categories of costs, so as to simplify the reimbursement process. Another issue we know is whether we can only pay in arrears or should only pay in arrears, or whether we should be in a position to pay some of the costs in advance. We've heard in particular from some public broadcasters, non-commercial stations, that it may be difficult for them to raise and spend the money as against a federal promise of reimbursement later. And finally, there is the kludge of issues that are sometimes referred to under the doctrine of comparable facilities. Whenever you're replacing older equipment with newer equipment, the question arises whether the equipment that you're buying is sufficiently comparable to what's being replaced. Now, that may be somewhat simpler here because this industry recently went through a transition, but some of the broadcasters that made that transition first may have equipment that's 10 or 15 or even more years old by the time it's replaced under this program. And we will face questions of how do you buy equipment that may be a different technology to replace older equipment, and is it sufficiently comparable, or are we gold plating? These are just some of the issues we've identified so far. One of the things we hope from our panelists and from you is to help us identify others. We're really more in search of questions today than we are in search of answers. What we want to do is try to make sure that when we come out with our notices of proposed rulemaking in the fall, that we thought of at least all the significant issues so that we can get comment on them and move as quickly as possible to orders and to an auction. So I won't say anything more. With that, I'll turn it back to Rebecca to introduce our terrific panelists.
Thank you, Bill. And we do have a terrific panel today. First, we have Jay Adrick, who's Vice President of Broadcast Technology at Harris Corporation. Jay is a leader in the design and integration of digital broadcasting systems. His career spans work in commercial and public radio and television stations, 8 years as a professor of communications at Xavier University in Cincinnati, and more than 30 years as an integrator of broadcast facilities. In addition to his Harris duties, Jay is vice chairman of the board of directors of the Advanced Television Systems Committee, ATSC, and chairs the Open Mobile Video Coalition Forum. Next, we have Brett Hahn, who is a principal with Deloitte Consulting's Federal Telecommunications Practice. He has over 25 years of experience in the field of telecom, including leading commercial telecom enterprises, working in government agencies, and helping to shape telecom policies in both the United States and Europe. Currently, Brett is program director of the 800 MHz Transition Administrator for the FCC's ongoing nationwide reconfiguration project. Next, we have Jane Mago, who's Executive Vice President and General Counsel of the NAB. Jane directs the work of the NAB's legal department and is responsible for all aspects of NAB's legal strategy. Her areas of expertise include the First Amendment, FCC ownership rules, political broadcasting, EEO, administrative law, enforcement, and licensing matters. Prior to joining NAB, Jane was with the FCC for 26 years and held many high-level positions, including general counsel, chief of the Office of Strategic Planning and Policy Analysis, and legal advisor to three commissioners. And finally, we have Patty Ticola, who's vice president of Spectrum at Sprint Nextel Corporation. Patty has over 20 years' experience in the wireless industry, with the last 9 spent at Nextel and then Sprint Nextel, where she's been responsible for managing Sprint's spectrum assets, including the successful completion of the 1.9 gigahertz BAS relocations and ongoing efforts of the 800 megahertz rebanding. So we've got a lot of expertise here that we'd like to mine today. But first, Jay has pulled together a very useful overview that will frame out today's workshop for us.
Thank you, Rebecca. we try to frame some of the issues and the challenges facing this repack process. First of all, let's look at the likely scenarios for a station to go through a channel change. The scenarios can be limited basically to three. First of all, a channel change within the technical limitations of the existing transmitter and antenna. The transmitter would employ currently supported technology, and it's estimated that probably less than 5% of the stations fall in this category, largely because the transmitters are set up in usually in three band segments within the UHF band, and antennas are, for the most part, channelized. Second would be a channel change beyond the technical limits of the existing supported transmitter and antenna. The transmitter is currently supported technology, and we think there are about 40% of the stations that fall in this category. And then there's the channel change beyond the technical limits, and the transmitter is unsupported. And that's largely because there have been some significant technology changes since digital television started to roll out. Solid-state devices have advanced in technology, and even the tube-type devices for the higher power transmitters have advanced. So there are about 55% of the stations that fall in this category. From a standpoint of station issues, there's the issue of how to remain on the air during this transition. Changing a transmitter to a different channel, changing out the antenna, perhaps the transmission line, beefing up the tower, all the things that have to be done, may prevent the station from transmitting over a period of time of anywhere from 3 to maybe 5 days. And that would be unacceptable as a broadcaster to be off the air for that period of time. So how do we bridge that? And in many cases, that's going to drive the need for a replacement transmitter and other elements of the replacement technology as opposed to just doing a channel change. I'd also point out that the tower specifications have changed dramatically since the DTV transition began. We're now on a Rev G of the tower specs, and I think you'll find that many of the towers out there today may even not pass the G specs, and once work commences on a tower that's out of spec, it becomes an insurability problem. Is there building space and power available for a second transmitter? What about local zoning laws and regulations that might prohibit a facility from being built? We have some classic examples in the DTV transition, like Denver, Colorado, where the DTV transition was held up for a long time. There are engineering considerations related to the building modifications, site surveys, tower loading, coverage, et cetera. And then how do we address stations with redundant transmitters or with multiple transmitter sites, such as we may have in, for example, New York City, where Empire State and 4 Times Square are both used as 4 Times Square as a backup site. There are some industry issues during the channel change. For example, there are only 14 qualified tower crews that can do tall sticks. That are both qualified, have the equipment, and have the insurability to be able to work on towers that are 1,000 to 2,000 feet in height. And if you look at how much time it takes to remove an antenna, put a temporary antenna up to keep the station on the air, then remove the antenna that's on top, replace it with a new antenna, transition over to that new antenna and take down the temporary, you're looking at a 5 to 6 week period of time. So it's not going to be easy for 14 crews to be able to cover all of the stations that might need to transition. Limited number of technical crews on the ground for the transmitter and for the other RF components. And then there's an issue of manufacturing capacity for replacement antennas and channel filters. One of the largest antenna manufacturers, down to about 30 people. There are only 2 major antenna manufacturers that are qualified to build antennas that take high-power UHF. How do you address and compensate stations with a common antenna facility? There are some of those around the nation. And if we have a station that may not have to channel change, but is part of a common antenna system, they may have an impact on their facility, even though they're not actually changing frequency, so how do we compensate them for the work? There are some issues presented by the laws of physics. As we move lower in frequency, the size of the antenna gets larger for an equal amount of gain. Or we could lower the gain of the antenna, keep it in size, and that requires a higher power transmitter to be able to offset the lower antenna gain. So we have a number of issues that we have to engineer in order to be able to make that happen. We have a few questions of elements that we don't know. Okay, we don't know how many stations will move and to what frequencies they're going to move to. What will be the impact of the move on each individual station based on their unique equipment and needs? Over what period of time will the channel change process occur? When's the start date? When's the end date? We think the transition period is 3 years, but can we actually accomplish it in 3 years? Will the channel change process take place across a region, a DMA, or by auction market? And finally, what do we think will need to be covered in the reimbursement? Certainly, there will be a number of engineering studies that have to be conducted, the transmitters themselves, transmitter installation, channel filters, which are unique to each station, the antenna, which in many cases is unique to that station's requirements, the tower rigging, the cost of permits, building modifications, electrical service modifications, leasing a temporary antenna and transmission line for the period of the transition, tower loading studies to make certain that we qualify for the insurance and the ability to modify the tower, proof of performance testing once the system's completed, coverage verification to make certain that we've replicated the licensed area, perhaps a transmission line because in some cases waveguide is used or transmission lines that will not work on certain frequencies, channel combiners if it's a common site, constructing a new tower if that's needed and the old tower can't be beefed up, certainly the legal services for filing the applications, and finally cleanup and removal of the old equipment. So I think that Rebecca gives you a pretty complete list of the things that we might have to compensate our broadcasters for. Back to you.
Well, thank you. I think that was very useful, and it does look like a comprehensive list. And Patty, I'm sure for the BAS transition, Sprint went through a similar planning process that we're kicking off now. But I'd be interested to know, were there any costs that you didn't expect and that you didn't plan for, and what surprised you most?
Thank you, Rebecca, and thank you for having me here. And I think Jay has certainly covered a lot of them. I think what we found on the BAS transition, starting really from the beginning, is we had a tax issue that had to be straightened out. I know that's a little bit later back on your list. And these are, in many cases, these are for-profit entities that do have tax considerations. And that actually on the BAS side did hold up to, you know, trying to understand what that issue is for the broadcasters and how, in fact, the IRS would look at it. This is obviously a little bit different the way it's structured, probably a little bit cleaner, but still it's something that I know that the individual licensees are going to be very concerned about. And that's taxes not only from a corporate standpoint, but also sales and use taxes. Manufacturers are going to be concerned with that as well. So, that's just an area that again, process-wise took us some time, not overly complex. You just have to, to know that you have to do it. As Jay mentioned early on, towers were a big issue for us. And you suddenly get out there and you've got huge scheduling issues with weather. So obviously, I'm sure this room panelists know better than certainly I do. But then you even get down to the oddballs where we have, I think in one case, a falcon or a hawk nesting on top of a tower and you can't disturb it because it's nesting season. And you sort of laugh, that's but unexpected. Then that's unexpected. and I think the tower climber is a little bit concerned when the hawk was protecting the nest with a large talent. And it's those types of things that, unfortunately you can't. You've now got to reschedule everything, and because we were going in groups, those types of sort of oddball things really take up more time than one would expect. So I think towers are certainly critical. The other area is, and not to be understated, is the lack of resources, the resources that really, they're very limited, and to be able to go across the country and coordinate in a coordinated effort with the skill sets that people need, and that's really across the board. And I think we did see some instances of smaller companies trying to step in with expertise they maybe didn't fully have that caused some of the challenges and the problems in timing and just not being able to stay on top of everything. So I do think that there is a very certainly needs to be very much of an awareness about the resources associated not only with the tower climbing, but the whole aspect of manufacturing the equipment, the testing of the equipment, and the coordination. There's really, and what we did is integration. This is just going to be probably, orders of magnitude more challenging when you look at the list that Jay just put out there. But yes.
Any from the broadcaster side, any unexpected?
Well, I think, first of all, let me just say thanks for holding the workshop, because I think it really will be important, and especially important to help identify the issues as we go forward. I think this is something that it's an area that could easily be overlooked, and then at the last minute find that you've really got some serious questions that have arisen. Jay did identify a lot of the costs, but there's oddball things too that could happen. Whether if you don't have enough information, you might have to have an expedited crew in, and that can be more costly than one might think in other circumstances. You also run into various zoning problems. The potential for a community that decides that they don't want to have something relocated to a particular spot, or even on a temporary basis, can be something that can add complications and additions to the adventure. One thing that Jay mentioned, and I wanted to emphasize it too, is sort of there's something unexpected that you may have someone who is not changing a channel at all, but has significant expenses because they're part of a tower. I understand that there's some 58% of the broadcasters out there are on shared towers. And if you're on a shared tower, if everything has to move and everything has to be altered on the tower, that can have some expenses that I'm not sure that anybody's quite figured out how to quantify and deal with yet. But those are going to be very important. And finally, I guess the thing I wanted to emphasize, too, is another piece of what Jay said in terms of the timing on this. We've got this three-year period, and I know Bill emphasized it too in his. And the 3 years that we're talking about here starts from the time that the auction ends. And how much expense you're going to have depends on how much planning you can get in. And so the later that 3 year starts, if you will, I think the better off you're going to be from a reimbursement and cost point of view.
Well, to get back to sort of the list of hard costs that Jay showed, Brett, one thing that we're trying to look for is opportunities either for us or maybe the industry to benefit from, to minimize or at least reduce these costs through economies of scale that you would get in either a bulk purchasing agreement for hardware, or I don't know if there could be a bulk services agreement for some of the soft costs. In your experience, how do you think we should be looking at that?
It's a good question. I think the points that Jane raised and Jay raised are spot on, that once you have an idea of the universe of potential costs and those activities related to those costs, that allows you to bound it and get cost estimates. So on the equipment side, I think there are significant opportunities for economies of scale once you determine who's the potential universe out there. Same thing potentially on the services side as well, but to a lesser extent. And one common thing I'm hearing throughout this is planning. The more planning you do up front allows you to determine the best and most efficient way to go forward on this. I liked Bill's point earlier that I categorize this as being fast, fair, and efficient. You have a policy goal of doing this as quickly as possible in 3 years. You want to be aggressive, but you want to be balanced on your cost side. And Jay's slide, I think, was really good, positive for my side, because it captures it. Captures at least the equipment side. Now maybe people maybe kind of catch their breath for a second, but that advanced planning is critical. And to your point is the outreach to all the other impacted users to find out from them at a regional level what would be the unanticipated cost will allow you to determine, should we put some in fixed price costs? Should we do some sort of flexible part to give the incentive to the broadcasters to move as quickly as possible? And finally, with Patty's point, there are other areas like tax implications, but the more that people know about them up front, the faster they can move. So that's the thing that I think will make the biggest difference in the advanced planning side.
Jay, from a vendor standpoint, unlike other transitions, Oh, and please speak into the microphones, everybody. I guess someone's having a hard time hearing. Thank you. From a vendor standpoint, unlike the previous transitions, in this transition, we really won't know what the repacking scheme looks like until after the auction. So despite that limitation, what can vendors be doing to ramp up for having equipment ready for the repacking?
Well, I don't think there's a lot they can do until we answer some of the unknowns. Let's talk a little bit about the schedule and what has to happen. We need to answer the unknowns. We need to know how many stations are moving and where they're moving to. Okay. Once we know that information, then there's going to be a planning period, as Brett has suggested, which I believe is going to be somewhere between 18 and 24 months. In that time, the consulting engineers are going to be able to look at the towers that have been identified as being affected. They're going to be able to look at the station requirements for coverage and determine what the antenna is going to look like in terms of design and how much transmitter power is needed, whether or not the existing transmission line is usable at that frequency or not. So we end up with the ability to, at that point, figure out what we need, order the items, and then pull the trigger on the three-year window, not when the auction's completed, but after this planning period. Without that planning period, we're going to have complete chaos. And I can tell you that every engineering consultant in this industry will be busy working with stations to lay out the map of how they get from current channel to new channel, and what is needed. Until we know what it looks like, there's not much we can do to plan ahead, because so many of the items, the transmitter, the antennas, are designed around the specific requirements of the station. Basic transmitter design doesn't change, but the fact that it might require a certain power level, be optimized at a certain power level, optimized at a certain frequency, or the antenna has a certain pattern to achieve coverage. All of those are variables that we can't go ahead and start cutting metal until we're knowledgeable on those issues.
And when you start cutting metal, the question's going to be, is a broadcaster replacing the actual equipment that they need, or is there an opportunity to upgrade? And so another challenge I think that we're going to have is drawing the line, as Bill mentioned in his overview, where is the line between replacing an exact piece of equipment versus upgrading to accommodate new functionality, not gold plating necessarily, but taking advantage of, possible, price reductions for more functionality. Did you encounter this challenge, Patty?
We did, and I actually would like to echo what Jay and Brett, everybody have said. Planning really is very critical, and that was a big aspect of a lot of our upfront time with very detailed inventories. I think there's a very point that shouldn't be lost as far as starting to actually manufacture the equipment. Quite frankly, in our experience, we were a little bit early on that. We worked out with the manufacturers trying some advanced purchases, and just, again, to get the quantity discount, so I think there's value in doing that, but the challenge that left us is some of the delays that then happen after that. And so I think to the extent that, and when I say delays that happen after that, technology actually improved. There were delays in people moving faster, equipment sort of, the next generation technology came out by the manufacturers, and we had pre-purchased equipment. So again, a little bit the cart before the horse. So I think it's very, going back to the planning is really very critical. On the upgrade side, I think we saw it certainly on the BAS relocation. We have the same issues on the 800 megahertz. I think there are certainly benefits to all to be able to do some upgrading. I think the challenge is always one of timing. When you're on a three-year program, you have to make sure that the licensee has the funding for an upgrade. It's it's something that they can execute in a timely fashion, and it doesn't hold everybody else up. But I think that there's certainly, I would expect there'd be some opportunities opportunities in this program for licensees to take advantage of, possibly some of the funding that would be otherwise providing them comparable facilities. But I think, again, it's just critical that there needs to be a stake in the ground that says if you have not committed upgrades, dollars, to the extent that there are that you have to provide up additional dollars, that the licensee has to, you know, show that they've have the ability to do the upgrade and can execute without the schedule slipping. I think that's actually very critical. So I think it's worthwhile to look at, but you just have to be very, broad in your requirements to allow somebody to do that.
Rebecca, I think you have to focus on this, talk about upgrades or gold plating, and it's not entirely clear to me what exactly goes into that. Because the real key here is going to be to provide service to the audience. And what the statute contemplates is that the services are going to be, the contours and the service areas are going to be largely the same. And so what you need to have is equipment that allows you to provide that kind of service. So I don't know whether you call it something of upgrade or whatever. I mean, you are replacing equipment that may be, as Bill put it, 15 years old. But the key goal here is you should be buying equipment that is, in fact, intended to achieve the statutory goal, which is to provide service to your audience. And that, I think, is going to be part of the whole effort. It's not gold plating, it's serving.
Sure, but there's providing programming to your audience, but there's mobile functionality, there's 3D functionality. So we are going to be asking ourselves, where are super high def? Where is the line? Mm-hmm. If you're suggesting that we should reimburse just for basic service, then then we'll take that. Brett, Jay, any guidance on where we can find that line?
I can answer a couple of things there. First of all, the mobile portion, which I'm very familiar with, having been part of the development team, is a separate add-on. It's very easily identified. It's not built into the equipment. The capability is built in, but the addition is a cost extra, and that would be easy to identify. If you have a station, for example, that's horizontal only, polarization, and they want to add a vertical component to enhance their mobile capability, that might be something that the station has to, pony up a few dollars for to add that capability. But it's really not a case of gold plating. It's it's a minor add-on. We're not talking about a lot of dollars here to add vertical component. There are very few opportunities, I guess, to go in and gold plate something because the technology has changed, and a lot of these transmitters that are out there, which by the time this happens will be close to 20 years old, are not capable of being supported and upgraded. So the only alternative is replace. So.
But each one has to be, again, I think Jay said this earlier, designed to fit the specific area, and that's important.
Understood.
To keep in mind as well.
And I would add one point is there's a common theme to all of us is on the planning side, because upgrades is one issue. It's an important issue, and as Patty said, you want to make sure that it does not hold up the overarching public policy goal of doing this within the three-year time part. And per that, one thing planning also does is give confidence to all the stakeholders. There's large broadcasters out there, but there's a lot of smaller ones, whether universities or religious broadcasters, who may not have all the resources that they have. And the planning and the consistency will give them confidence that this program is going to treat them in a fair manner and as efficiently as possible. And that's another part. It's not just program planning, but program planning gives confidence to the executives when they make his or her decision for their entity.
And to follow up on that planning, that's actually the reason we're having this workshop now, so early in the process, because we're very sensitive to the need for planning too. And as we design this program, we're also acutely aware of the three-year time period in the statute. But how we want to be accountable, but we only have a limited amount of time. So how should we try to balance speed and efficiency with accuracy, with hyper-accuracy in handling federal funds? Brett?
I think there's a lot of alternatives out there, and there's other executive branch agencies, DOD, that you can look for, NSF grants. But because you have an overarching policy goal, you want to make sure that you meet like GAO standards and other standards for the hill that they will look over it, but at the same time meet your standards of accomplishing this in a fairly and efficiently process. And there's like cost plus contracts or cost plus incentive contracts that give people, entities, incentives to get it done. And also, because of the planning side, you should have, with robust planning, a reasonable idea of your costs. And if there are exceptions, like Patty mentioned with the towers, you can put those in on for what are called change notices, but those should be usually on the de minimis side. Those should not be the norm, but really it should be something that's unusual. And so you can hold folks accountable for their own plans. Plus, because some of the broadcasters are small, you may want to be able to treat them in a way that there is some forward funding, but on a quarterly basis they have to true up, so you're not putting the taxpayer at a long-term risk. Right. And that also puts some responsibility on both sides. You have to assume goodwill, but also have checks and balances on it.
I think another point, Rebecca, is if the markets are addressed on a market-by-market basis for the change-out, you've got tower crews that are there. They don't have to relocate. They can hit, you know, all the jobs in a given market. The transmitter crews can do the same thing. It will certainly cut down on some of the transition costs. So I would highly recommend that type of an approach be looked at.
You know, while this is something that's sort of unique to the FCC, I think that Brett's point is a good one, that it's not unique to the government as a whole, that there be sort of these kinds of reimbursement programs. And I think relying on some of the expertise that you may be able to find elsewhere could be something that's very important for how this process goes forward. And I know that in talking with some of our members, particularly in the public stations, there has been a real concern raised about where the funding comes from up front. You know, is there some way of having that? And I think there are various programs that will help to get that out and make the program more possible.
So whether we pay in advance or in arrears, what would be the pros and cons of a sort of flat fee, these bands of fixed dollar amounts that we would reimburse versus paying exactly against receipts, if you will?
Well, paying exactly against receipts adds an administrative burden on the other side. It gives you kind of surety, but it gives you a lot of administrative burden for capturing all those receipts. And also paying in arrears, you want to make sure that there's an incentive for people to get in as quickly as possible. You don't want it to make it unintentionally adversarial. You want to actually have, you know, good intentions on both sides to move it forward. I think that having, though, accountability, whether on a quarterly basis or other parts, is important for the trust and confidence and making sure that people submit their invoices to match. There's always going to be, in the real world, some differential. You know, I've rarely seen, you know, invoices come into the penny, and you want to make sure that folks, if let's say they're 5% over, they get a look. You know, 10% over, it's a hard look, and beyond that, perhaps, you know, they'll have to justify at their own cost if they don't have prior a warning of the additional costs or time. So there's a responsibility on the other side to make sure that their costs are in line with their tasks. But as Jay and Jane have mentioned, and so has Patty, this is fairly well plowed ground. There's not a lot of new tasks or new activities out there. So somebody coming out with something brand new, they would have to have a high bar of justification. Why is it? Fixed price contracts transfers some of the risk over to the entity, but that could be an alternative for them to move as quickly as possible. They say, look, we're going to get it done, but we'll take the responsibility and the risk of saying, yes, we agree to that. So there's a lot of different alternatives out there. I think that, as Jane and I have mentioned, there's other examples in the executive branch agencies of cost plus that DHS, DOD, other DOT use that may give you the incentive structure to make sure everybody moves in the same part, but also meets with OMB guidelines.
And I think that's one of the challenges that, you know, we constantly say no we like to frequently say, well, it's a large group of people. There are a lot of similarities, and in fact, there are probably more differences than there are similarities. And to try to treat a large group very comparable or similarly is going to be, I think, a challenge. And just I think to on the change order point. On the VAS side, we probably had over 60% of our licensees went through change orders, if not closer to 80%. So, again, lots of various reasons for that. I think some of it could have been addressed by a little bit more planning up front, but I think it's not necessarily appropriate to assume that the change order percentages are going to be low, unless, of course, you're doing a fixed price mm-hmm. type of activity. And there's some licensees that I imagine might like that. There's some licensees that I think would be very concerned with that particular approach. I think since you're looking at drafting, language is actually very, very critical when it comes to talking about what requirements are. And I think the 800 megahertz report and orders is very an example where, interestingly enough, the BAS reimbursement was treated very differently than the 800 megahertz reimbursement. And the overhead, the language in the order or what's not in the order and the way it gets implemented has put a much bigger burden on the 800 megahertz licensees than was put on the broadcaster licensee. So I think language and really parsing almost every word in the actual document, unfortunately, is something that is going to take time and to have to go through because I think, as Brett will attest to, there are certain things that that the transition administrator is required to do because of the auditing that's required, which is a very different process than on the BAS side. A little unusual that they're both fall in the same order and they're held to different standards. But I think that really is that's very much because of the language and the way the order is written. So I think you're going to have to see that and assume that licensees are going to be very different than different licensees are going to be very differently situated and have very different requirements. And some, as we've said, may need the payments up front. Then it's a question of, well, how much documentation and burden do you put on them to build new accounting systems, those types of things, when they might be a small licensee. So I think having a lot of knowledge about that and having a very fulsome conversation with all of the experts and licensee representatives up front, again, back to planning. Mm-hmm. I think we're all kind of harping on the planning, but that, you know, that will be a very big something that needs to be addressed very early on in the process.
Trying to address the situation with a sort of a one-price-fits-all is not going to work. What you might consider would be in this planning period, at a certain point in the planning period, the station submits an estimate based on the quotations they've gotten from all of their suppliers, and that the reimbursement be based initially on that, and then a true-up period that could occur after the project is completed. So you go in initially with what we think it will take, and then when you actually have created the transition and you're successfully operating, and you've had a chance to look at all the last invoices, you true it up, and maybe there's some money that's given back, and maybe there's some money that still has to be owed to the station.
We seem to be going back and forth on topics a little bit, but I think in terms of some of the stations that might need upfront payments versus some that might not, I mean, there may be different ways of creating an incentive structure that if you can get your plans early on, that maybe you can get something up front sooner, I mean, that kind of thing might be helpful to the whole process.
Yeah, but Brett mentioned incentives, and I wanted to come back to that. What other incentives would there be? Could we offer to encourage broadcasters to come in on time, under budget, et cetera?
Well, cost plus incentive contracts would be your classic, and DoD does some of those contracts where there's an incentive for the entity to come in on time or a little bit shorter than time. And there's a disincentive to come in above cost and behind schedule. Think of this as like anybody who's done house remodeling. You know, that's a basic, you know, they're going to give incentive to have it get done right and accountable. And if it's done in a shorter period of time, there's some benefit to the contractor or to the licensee on this part to it. And there's other federal programs that have looked at this part. And on the other side, if there's a disincentive for being much longer or higher cost without justification, there's that's an important caveat. But I think that sort of outreach is important because all the licensees aren't different. Some of them have more resources and wherewithal to handle this. But there are other executive branch agencies that look at cost plus, fixed fee, cost plus incentive contracts that can give incentives to move it quicker, because you all do have the overarching public policy guideline of having this repack or reconfiguration done within X years. So there is justification that can be given to the American public, to taxpayers, to the General Accounting Office, of why the structure was set up in a certain way.
And now I think we probably can't lose sight of the fact that this is coming after an auction. So you have now auction winners who, I think if a lot of this is not really spelled out at the time of the auction, the Treasury will lose from the auction standpoint just because of the unknowns that can happen as a result of, wow, really what are the ramifications if it's not 3 years, if it goes to 4 or 5 or 6 years, a licensee has just, you know, they are now planning on using spectrum and having access to that spectrum and not having that, I think some more definitive repercussions, I think it's probably the best term on it, for a licensee, for an auction winner, is I think a challenge from an auction, from the, getting the maximizing your auction proceeds. I think you really have to have, I think, a lot of these questions answered from a what happens if during the auction process.
That's one of the themes that you're going to hear from the broadcasters constantly, is the more knowledge we have, the better off this is all going to go. And whether it's from the planning process or the complete transparency in each phase of it, the earlier that that we have some understanding of what might happen as the repacking goes forward is going to be the most important piece to it, and that will help with the planning to know. I mean, and we can't have that period starting before people have some clue as to what they're going to do, because otherwise this is going to fall apart.
Yeah. But I take, you know, I'm always a glass half full type of person, is that it is an aggressive schedule, but it's doable. It's aggressive but balanced. And because of Jay's firm and Jane's part and Patty's, this is knowable to the industry writ large. There are not a lot of new tasks or activities that people are going to come with. It's just the complexity of planning and program management. So that upfront part does give confidence to the broadcasters. And to Patty's point, which I think is very spot on, it gives confidence to the people who are going to bid on the auctions. So while we're discussing a lot of the complexities, I actually see that as a positive, because that is going to help us move faster and more efficiently later on.
I have one area, though, Brett, that I think is a great concern, and that is the tower and antenna work.
Yeah.
As I mentioned in my opening, there were 14 tower crews that are capable of doing this work in the U.S. Typical on-site work is about 5 weeks. If you're talking about hanging, first of all, travel to the site, set up, hang a temporary antenna and transmission line, remove the existing antenna, drop a new antenna in, change over, and then drop a temporary back off the tower. 5 weeks, you get 14 crews, work them 52 weeks out of the year. You're at 434 stations if nothing goes wrong that can change out antennas. Until we know how many stations are actually required to change antennas, we better be careful with the assumption that we can do it in 3 years. I think that's probably the limiting factor in this whole process.
Well, even though I was going to take questions at the end, that's a perfect introduction for this question, which is, so is Jay saying that if the current statutory 3-year deadline remains, there will be chaos? That is something Congress would have to change, right? Chaos?
Well, it's possible.
Maybe uprising.
It's possible that we might ask for that change. We might have to ask for that change.
I think Jay's point is really well taken, though. I mean, there's only so much you can do within the physical capabilities. I mean, you really do have problems. I think Patty referred to it. I heard at various times people tried to hire crews that were less experienced to try to do something to move things along. And there were actual deaths, quite a few, as a matter of fact, that occurred because people who did not know what they were doing we're trying to climb up these towers, and we're not talking small towers. We're talking the very tallest of towers. So you really do have to stick with the crews that know what they're doing, that can then actually provide the service. And you've got weather delays that can happen because, you know, you're trying to do something someplace in upstate New York, you may well have a certain part of the year that is not really capable of doing the timing. I think that, again, I think we're back to our planning to some extent, and we can maximize the time that those crews can do it, but it may well be possible that we may need a little bit more time.
Which, to answer the question, that would be something that Congress would have to change.
Mm-hmm. But it's also within the commission's power in terms of, you know, declaring when the end of the auction is and timing that to be.
Oh, okay, that's a fair point.
let me just say out front that, you know, what in terms of what you declare as the actual date, and it seems to me that when everyone has full knowledge of what might be going on is not a bad definition of when this is ready to go.
And, you know, these costs that we're reimbursing, they're all for the end goal of having broadcasters keep their audience coverage, et cetera. But to what extent should private negotiations play a role in trying to achieve your post-repacking interference issues, if there are any? And because private negotiations do play a meaningful role today for some stations. If the FCC can't take a particular action, often remedies are negotiated privately. Do you see any room for that in this process, particularly if it ends up being a slow or longer process than we anticipate?
You know, I'm not sure I understand exactly how that fits with when you're talking about the equipment. I mean, you've got to sort of, you have to order your equipment and design it to meet the specifications for where your channel's going to be and how you're going to be serving your particular area. And so I don't quite know where the private negotiations part of that comes in and how you try to deal with that. I mean, it doesn't seem to fit with this. Maybe later on you can do something that you can try to work with each other, but just up front, I'm not sure I quite understand. Jay, maybe you've got...
No, I would agree. The likelihood is that there will be some interference cases that have to be resolved, but until we know what we don't know today, and we've had a chance for the consulting engineers to take a pass at it, I think we're only... talking in conjecture here, not with the real situations.
Jay, is it true on because, you know, certainly on the BAS side, it was very coordinated by markets. On the 800 side, and we obviously have very strict interference issues and very much outlined in, or mandated in the RNO, but is interference sort of in the middle of everything? So you have, you know, is that given, and what you don't know, obviously, about which licensees and stations are going to be moving, I mean, ultimately, presumably, there would be a band plan that would limit interference when everybody's done. Do you have a concern as to how interference, sort of as everybody's working the process, that trying to manage interference in the sort of the interim period is something that is also going to be a big concern, or is that something that's a little bit more... easily managed?
Well, again, we have to see the model that's being proposed to understand, you know, what the channel, what the spacing will be between markets on the reuse of a channel. There are terrain factors. There are a lot of factors that enter into whether or not two markets are going to create interference. The propagation along the East Coast, where you get ducting out over the ocean, is a lot different than the propagation that we experience, for example, in Ohio or other parts of the Midwest. So all of those things are going to have to be taken into consideration. We also have border issues. We have treaties with Canada and treaties with Mexico. And they're in their process of doing a digital transition in both areas. So that's going to enter into channel assignments. So it's going to be a real challenge to fit everything into a band plan that preserves coverage. Again, what we don't know, how many stations go away. Yeah. Until we have answers for the unknowns, we won't be able to get to the other answers that we need to have.
I'd just like to make the point that when we're talking about engineering size, engineering is usually a result of a policy decision, and that one of the policy decisions people have to make, really the commission needs to address, is what is practical, because you have a policy guidance of doing this within a three-year time frame. And we assisted Ofcom, the British regulator, in their broadcasting repack, and they decided that duplicating exact coverage just wasn't practical. They decided then to do it on different factors, obviously with lots of outreach, but they determined that the engineering side, covering all the different terrain factors, et cetera, was going to become a huge work stream in and of itself and hinder them from reaching their ultimate policy goal of doing a repack, including with their neighboring countries, Belgium, Netherlands, and France, that were also impacted by this. So they decided to have a more different standard than the exact coverage that was beforehand. So that is a policy decision that needs to be made up front, because the result was that engineering became an issue that was just dragging the process out. It's very important, but yet it's always a balance of what meets the ultimate public policy goal, including, as we discussed earlier, on costs, on reimbursement. It's always balancing out that goal to make sure you meet the overarching congressional intent and administration intent of meeting this goal within X years.
I think that the policy goal, as you talk about it, is also addressed in the statute in terms of what is it that Congress really wanted here. And it's not just to get this done in 3 years, but it's also to preserve as much as possible the service areas. And I the exact language of the statute's escaping me at this moment, but it's a the Congress already made a determination that to the extent that the commission can, that it should in fact preserve. Now, that's not saying exact, and I think your point is well taken, that that exact is perhaps something that we're not going to achieve. But on the other hand, it needs to be pretty close, I think, from the statutory perspective, and that's all one of the elements that gets factored in here as well.
Yeah, we need to use reasonable efforts to replicate the coverage, and also pay the reasonable cost to do that.
That reasonable world.
I know. It's a lifesaver. So now, if we could just step back and go down the line, if you were to look back at the lessons learned from similar programs that we've alluded to so far, what would they be? What do you think is worth sharing with us? Brett or Patty, you could start off with the 800 rebanding or BAS.
Sure. I think, and I will say it again, lessons learned is you cannot plan enough. And I don't want to beat that dead horse, but that obviously keeps a lot of bad things from happening down the road. And I think that is very critical. And I think it's very critical to get people engaged very early in the process. And they're not getting engaged is something that really can't be allowed. I think there needs to be a very aggressive, whether it's, I think the marketing outreach campaigns are excellent, but at some point if you have licensees that just don't feel like engaging, they can't sit there and not engage for 6 months, 8 months, 10 months. I think there really needs to be, I think, very prescriptive language almost as to what happens along this process. We see that, we've seen that actually on both the BAS side, and we see on the 800 megahertz side, where you have licensees for whatever reasons, whether and it's obviously very different because Sprint is a public entity, a public corporation that or non-governmental. They're holdouts waiting for the big check. And, so it's a very different dynamic than what you're obviously, I think, would expect to see in this particular environment. But we need to have, I think, very meaningful outlines as to how the planning process, how one has to engage in it, and how one has to participate actively and make decisions quickly. I think going back to Brett's point and what I've mentioned before, is there has to be a balance on how you set up the sort of the back office and the support and the documentation. Those efforts truly, when you talk about the management of the cost benefit of how much is too much when you're asking for documentation and given the public policy requirements and needs to get the spectrum out there and to get the licensees, the broadcasters repacked and to accomplish all of this, I think there has to be a fair amount of consideration given to, you know, where do you draw those lines between the right balance on documentation and audit requirements. I think those. I can end with planning, but I'll go back to the rest of the table with Brett on this one.
Yeah, I think, you know, as all of you have heard, that there's one common theme here, and we did not prearrange this. If I can get one more P in there, I'll be very happy. But that also allows to address points that Jay has made in terms of manufacturing capacity or rural issues. One thing Patty and I in the 800 megahertz program quickly realized that mountain states in Utah, you just can't get to those towers in the wintertime. So those are things that you need to quickly address in order to meet your goals. Also, that planning gives transparency, because the one thing that will drive people to think that there's something else happening is if they feel that they're not being treated in a fair and efficient format, or it's not transparent. And that way, to get ahead of that and outreach to them, pulls them in and gets them engaged. And then to Patty's point, you quickly find out who are either the kind of lazy ones or the outright recalcitrant ones. And there are going to be always that, you know, hopefully de minimis percentage, but there are going to be the ones that you're going to have to spend a lot of your time focusing on, saying why, what's going on. And then there has to be some sort of reciprocity on their side, because it is a benefit to the entire country. And so this is not just a something that is done for them, to them. They have to have some sort of reciprocity to be working with you and understanding there are clear timelines, that the one person cannot hold up the entire process. That's not allowable or acceptable, really.
Well, given the fact that there aren't second channels for this transition, given the fact that a broadcaster can waive their reimbursement amount if they so choose, then there may well be holdouts. So how should we be thinking about building in non-monetary incentives to prevent holdout behavior?
You know, I don't know that you should assume that there'll be holdouts. I don't accept that premise. I mean, I think that you do have to recognize that there will be, everyone will be treated in a unique way or will have unique circumstances. And I think this is what Patty was referring to. I mean, not everyone has the same resources to devote to figuring this out up front, whether you're talking about some of the public stations versus a single owner versus, a group owner of some sort, that you may well be in a situation where someone is not a holdout per se, but they have different circumstances. And I think contemplating and planning for what those circumstances might be is going to be the real key here. Our planning thing, I was remembering a friend of mine who always used to say, previous planning prevents pretty poor performance, and pretty wasn't the word that he used. but it's something that, seriously, in terms of what you have to do is, I think, understanding each unique situation. I like Patty's idea of having some sort of, sort of basic guidelines that are flexible enough that in different circumstances you can adapt. I think it's going to be a real key here.
I think there's been on BAS and you speak to BAS, Patty, and on 800. There's an understanding of the different licensee and different regional impacts. So clearly, Utah is not the same as New Jersey, and there's, both in terms of soft costs and in some cases hard costs. But usually hard costs are there. There's very little deviation on the hard costs, and the soft costs you can plan for those, so you can quickly find, it's kind of a reasonable man test of the 80-20 rule, that are these people raising a legitimate issue or are they just being recalcitrant? And that allows you to get up to speed really quickly and to figure out how you can solve that problem.
There's a classic story. Repack is not new. We went through this back in 52, 53 in the early days of analog television. And there's a book out. It was written by the former president of Taft Broadcasting. And he was at a station in Huntington, West Virginia. It was on Channel 3, actually had been assigned to Channel 3, and they were going to go on at 100 kilowatts, which was at that time would have been the highest power low-band VHF station. And there was a Channel 3 assignment in Columbus, Ohio that belonged to Crosley Broadcasting. They were supposed to go to Channel 4, but they were recalcitrant. They absolutely refused. They weren't going to abide by the FCC move to Channel 4. And so the general manager of the station in West Virginia went ahead and got special temporary authorization to do his testing and came on the air one morning on Channel 3. They were an NBC affiliate, as was the station in Columbus, and everything was fine during the Today Show. At the end of the Today Show, they both went to local programming, and in Columbus, Ohio, they were seeing an overlap of picture from the station in Huntington, right? And immediately the phone rang from the people at Crosley saying, you know, what are you doing? You're on our frequency. And they went back and forth, and it was a matter of days after that they finally moved to Channel 4 to get out from under the interference. So you can force people to move.
All well, there, that sounds like private negotiation right there. So maybe there is a role after all. You know, we haven't touched on NTIA has a program for the LPTV digital conversion reimbursement, and for they have a public television cost reimbursement program. That would seem to be relevant to ours, what we're planning. Any lessons there that we could benefit from?
Do you want to take it? Or?
Sure. Having grown up in the public broadcasting world, many of these stations are operating on a day-by-day basis in terms of their cash flow, mm-hmm. and don't have the money to go out and buy very expensive equipment. In fact, a lot of the boards on these public corporations actually prohibit purchase orders from being issued unless the money is in the treasury and reserved. So I think you're going to find that the public stations are going to require upfront money, certainly to make that transition. They've lost their funding from a lot of other sources, and hard equipment dollars are very, very scarce in today's economy. So I think that's the one way you're going to be able to get these stations to move forward.
I do think that's one of the key lessons, is when you're dealing with entities that have less resources, that the more that you can do to help them up front is going to be key to any success that you have.
Okay. Why don't we see if there are any questions? If you'd go up to the mic, if anyone has a question, feel free.
Hello, thank you. My name is Marcus Shaw, and thank you for taking the question. Jane, I have a question for you.
Sure.
As it pertains to the broadcasters and how they're thinking about making their decision, whether, you know, where they're going to set reserve prices for participating in the auction, if they're really thinking about this whole process as a, you know, essentially a big corporate finance decision based on the cost incurred that they may or may not reimburse. And secondly, whether or not for smaller broadcasters that may not have the resources to manage this situation, whether there is a potential for consolidation of smaller broadcasters ahead of entering the auction.
I think you're going to areas that are a little outside of our direct reimbursement today. I mean, that's really goes, if I understood your question properly, to likely what's the strategy for going into the incentive auctions themselves, going into the reverse auction part of it. And to be very honest about it, I have not been privy to any of the conversations that anyone has had to think about that. So I really can't answer that part of the question. In terms of smaller broadcasters, I know that they, you know, are looking at this and wondering more from the reimbursement point of view how exactly they're going to be able to manage the transition time for those that are choosing to stay on the air. Do they want to go into channel sharing? Do they want to do some other arrangement? How are they going to pay for this? And I'm not sure I know the answer to that just right now.
Good afternoon. Jay, Greg Herman with Spectrum Evolution. Jay, I have a question for you. You developed some numbers at the back of your presentation that anticipated the costs of channel changes under different scenarios. And then I also heard some discussion about the aspirations to replicate coverage for a station, at least certainly to provide an incentive for them to want to participate on any level. Have you anticipated, or can you speak to the benefit or lack thereof, of distributed transmission systems being deployed, A, from a cost perspective, and B, do they help facilitate that replication by essentially bringing the power a little closer to the ground and maybe help to make sure that any full power station that's displaced gets back all of what they arguably deserve?
Sure. First of all, I'll point out that in addition to the presentation that I gave at the opening of the program, there is a more detailed handout that there are copies in the room, and we've left a copy with Rebecca, and I guess it will be available on the website.
On the table back
there. Right. So there are some numbers that relate to various models there. Greg, to answer your question about distributed transmission, it may be a solution for certain markets. There are issues with distributed transmission, as we all know, with the ATSC or the 8VSB modulation. And largely, those issues are, do we have the appropriate terrain to separate transmission sites that would prevent the distributed transmission system from interfering, creating bands of interference within the marketplace that the station's trying to serve? And just how great are those bands of interference? That's largely dependent upon things like power and height. But it's certainly not out of the question to think about that. Now, it does drive operating costs from the standpoint that each transmitter has to be fed with an original signal from the studio. So we end up with more microwave or fiber interconnect and operating costs for the station to be able to operate in a distributed model. There have been some very successful deployments. There's one in Reading, Pennsylvania. There's one, I believe, in the southern Missouri that recently went on the air. Idaho Public Television is doing a distributed transmission plan with ATSC. So it's certainly possible that this would be a solution. Again, until we know how many channels we've got to reclaim, until we know how many stations, where the stations are, and what the individual market conditions are, and also the border issues. We've got this 200-mile path along both borders that we have to worry about. Until we know all the factors, it's kind of hard to say that we should, you know, go one way or the other. But it is a technology that certainly should be considered.
And I have one more quick question, only because I think when you're looking at the costs associated with it, obviously it could be higher potentially based on what you said.
Could very well be.
But if it served the function of replicating coverage, maybe that's a benefit.
Right. It could be higher, and one of the issues that we'll run into from more of a zoning, if you will, is that the tower placements are critical in order to minimize the overlap of signals in the interference bands and place the interference bands where they'll do the least harm to the station's overall coverage. So, can we put a tower in a particular neighborhood where the engineering study says it has to be in order to properly serve that community?
I was also curious, as you talked about displacement of stations and they cannot tolerate being off the air for any extended period of time and how to contend with that. Do any of you have a thought about whether or not, since we don't have second channels like existed during the last transition, there's an entire universe of low-power television stations that arguably could serve to help bridge the gap during the time that a major reconstruction might be necessary for a full power. Do you anticipate that if a low power station were willing to lease capacity so that the station wasn't on the air in order to make it easier or a more beneficial or seamless transition to community, that the funds might be made available to lease the low power station? Well, just curious about whether or not that had been considered.
That's certainly a solution. One of the things I would point out, though, is that the over-the-air use of the spectrum for delivering television is on the increase. The NAB recently came out with a study that said that it went from like 15% to about 18.2% for primary television service. And the secondary television service is very debatable, but I'm sure is much, much higher, where people have second or third sets in the household that are not connected to a wire or to a satellite. So going to low power there may disenfranchise those viewers. That would be on the negative side of using that as a means of transition.
Jane, did you want to respond to the?
No, I think Jay's comment's
okay.
Fine.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay.
One more.
Oh.
Hello, I'm Amy Brown. I'm also with SpectrumEvolution.org. And Rebecca, you mentioned just a few minutes ago that some broadcasters may waive their reimbursement expenses. And from what I understand in the statute, they can do that in exchange for having flexible use of the spectrum and using alternate technologies. I'd love for you to elaborate on that a little bit. And then if the FCC sees in the wisdom to allow that after all this, it seems to me that it would be wise to allow broadcasters to experiment with that now, to strongly encourage more broadcasters in the future to do that and not have to spend as much money reimbursing. And I'd like to get opinions on that as well.
Well, I don't have the statute in front of me, but I believe in exchange for waiving the reimbursement funds, a broadcaster could elect to have a waiver of certain service rules. I don't remember alternative technologies being in the language of the statute. Flexible use, right. But no, we have not yet burrowed into that, to interpreting that part of the statute.
Do you have a view? Just saying that I think that that's a piece of the statute that a lot of people are trying to figure out exactly what it does mean and how it may be something that would be useful as we go forward. I can't say that there are clear answers at this time. But, I mean, your other point, Amy, of that perhaps we should be letting different experiments go out is certainly one that's worthy of consideration.
Anybody else? Then we have a question from our web audience. Has the commission considered whether the broadcaster relocation fund would cover the costs of lease termination costs if a station is required to move from one tower to a different tower and must pay out an existing lease or pay a lease termination fee? Well, right now, I don't think we're contemplating any geographic move. So in the repack, we're hoping just to assign broadcasters new frequencies to avoid having them locate to another tower. So we are not considering that at this time.
Rebecca, that might be necessary, though. I mean, I'm not an engineer, but I understand that if you have to you try to consolidate to minimize your moves, that you may well be in a situation where someone does have to move from their current tower location to another tower. And that I would say that I wouldn't throw that out as an option at this point. I'd certainly say that it's something that ought to be considered as an element if it gives the incentive for someone to be able to make the move, then you would want to you'd want to keep that in the mix.
Yeah, no, we haven't ruled out anything because we're at the beginning of our planning process.
Yeah.
But that's sort of our current thinking. But obviously, if it's it will have to be taken into consideration.
Mm-hmm.
We have another web question. Many believe that the $1.75 billion will only serve to cover a little over half of the projected cost of the channel repacking. What will happen when that money runs out? Well, I know that the FCC won't have any money, so I think I would assume, I have no doubt that Jane and her team would kick into gear and probably go back to Congress for a gross up. is my guess.
I think it's important that there be the assistance here, and yes, there would, I'm not sure that Congress is going to be too receptive, but at some point, I think it's important to cover all the costs, and particularly to make sure that this happens. And I know that there's been a lot of concern and a lot of discussion about that, that we'll cross that bridge when we get to it.
Again, it's one of those unknowns. How many stations are we going to relocate?
That should be a reason why we would minimize the number of changes that would have to happen.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Agreed. Well, if there aren't any more questions, then we can thank our panelists for their time. Thank you.
Thank you.